everybody, and welcome to the 107th Kritzerland show here at Kritzerland downstairs in the living room instead of our usual home at Feinstein's upstairs at Vitello's. How many of you have been with us before? And how many of you are new to us? Well, for those of you who may be new to us, and I hope there are a few, I always have to explain in our shows that I am elderly and must read from the paper. And of course, in the shows, I have a little clipboard and the paper that I read from. But here, the papers are all over the place. So if my eyes start to take on a life of their own, you'll know why. Now, I've been doing that elderly joke since the very first show in September of 2010, and of course the joke was that I wasn't really elderly back in September of 2010, but here we are 10 years later, and all good things come to those who wait. Oh dear. Anyway, I'm very excited about tonight's show. It's called Kritzerland Influencers, and I got the idea from this show because I would go on YouTube occasionally, and I'd see these YouTube influencers, and I thought, you know, haven't we all been influenced in our lives, just not by a bunch of 15-year-olds influencing I have no idea what and making millions of dollars? Certainly, I have been influenced in my life by songs and shows and singers. And that's what tonight's show is all about. Now, normally, I choose all the songs for the shows, but tonight, I let each singer choose one song that was very influential in their lives. So, tonight you're going to hear songs you'll know a lot, film and theater songs. You're going to hear a few songs that you may not know quite as well, and you're definitely going to hear a couple of songs that you don't know at all. In other words, a Kritzerland show. So, why don't we just get this show on the road? Now, when I was a kid, I loved good, bad, and ugly science fiction movies. I just couldn't get enough of them, really. And I'll tell you how influential they were in my life. I ended up writing a movie and directing a movie called The Creature Wasn't Nice. And then I wrote a musical with my friend David Wechter called The Brain from Planet X. And both of those were send-ups of the good, the bad, and the ugly science fiction movies that I grew up with in the 1950s. So anyway, I love writing opening numbers, and they set the tone for the show. They bring you into its world. So tonight, we're opening with the opening number of The Brain from Planet X, which is conveniently titled The Brain from Planet X. So won't you please welcome Robert Yacko, Michael Gabiano, Ali Gutierrez, Chloe Haven, John Massey, Ellie Oliver, Scott Sr., Mackenzie Wrap to sing The Brain from Planet X.
You will quake with fear, you will shake with fright when the tale is told of that fateful night. 20 million miles to Earth they traveled, and not just to say hello. No, they had a plan, and their plan was clear. Yes, they had a purpose for being here. When they came from their forbidden planet, their plan started to grow.
It's the brain for Planet X. It's Invasion USA. It's the fiend without a face, the enemy from space, the way the Earth stood still that day. It's a brain from Planet X, and it came from outer space. It's the planet they are hatching, bodies they are snatching, what they're gonna do to conquer the human race.
Unidentified flying objects over the San Fernando Valley.
People of Earth, beware this warning. When you wake up tomorrow morning, you're in for a big surprise. You will not believe your eyes, so keep watching the skies.
When the saucers land and when worlds collide, then the Earth is in for a bumpy ride. Giant ants and shrinking men, forget them. When X the unknown's unfurled. So beware, my friends, they are on their way. They are coming here, and it's time to pray. Will the earth survive the thing that's coming, the thing from another world?
It's the brain from Planet X. Will this evil plan give birth? Will we best be at the ready, stalwart, strong and steady, to defend this island Earth? It's the brain from Planet X. It's the creatures from the sky. And you'll wish it was a dream when people start to scream, when horror rules the day and people begin to die. Because of the brain, because of the brain, because of the brain, the brain from Planet X.
Robert, Yacko, and our great group of brain people. Our next song is from Godspell, the musical by John Michael Teblak and Stephen Schwartz. Godspell began life at Carnegie Mellon as a master's thesis and non-musical play, and it then went off-Broadway to Café La Mama. The show came to the attention of producer Edgar Lansbury, who was the brother of Angela. And Stephen Schwartz was hired to write songs for it. And the newly musicalized version of Godspell opened off-Broadway at the Cherry Lane Theater and 3 months later moved to the Promenade Theater. The show was an instant sensation, running 2,124 performances. It also had a hit cast album and a hit single in Day by Day. I have several 6 degrees of separation with Godspell, including the fact that its original Jesus, Stephen Nathan, went from playing Jesus to starring in my motion picture, the first nudie musical. He went on from there to be a producer of many TV shows, including Bones, and frankly, I'd like to have 6 degrees of separation with his bank account. I've also had the great pleasure of producing the cast album of the York Theatre revival of the show back in 2001, featuring a cast of then unknowns, newcomers, who have since gone on to some pretty impressive careers, including Leslie Kritzer, Barrett Foa, Chad Kimball, Carpathia Jenkins, and Shoshana Bean. Here to sing all for the best, welcome Kerry O'Malley and Kerry O'Malley.
When you feel sad or under a curse, your life is bad, your prospects are worse, your wife is sighing, crying, and your olive tree is dying. Temples are graying and teeth are decaying and creditors weighing your purse. Your mood and your robe are both the deep blue. You'd bet that Job had nothing on you. I don't forget that when you get to heaven, you'll be blessed. Yes, it's all for the best. Some men are born to live at ease, doing what they please, richer than the bees are in honey. Never growing old, never feeling cold, pulling pots of gold from thin air. The best in every town, best at shaking down, best at making mountains of money. They can't take it with them, but what do they care? They get the center of the meat, cushions on the seat, houses on the street where it's sunny. Summer's at the sea, winter's warm and free, all of this and we get the rest. But who is the lamb for the sun and the sand for? You guessed, it's all for the best. Some men are full of the baddies, doing what they please, under and the bees are in honey.
Your life is bad.
Never growing old, never feeling
your
cold, pulling pots of gold from thin air.
Your wife
the
is
best
sighing,
in every town, Mr. Chicken Down, Mr. Making Mountains,
all
its trees dying.
They can't take rain,
and teeth are decaying, and predators weighing
your
purse. They get in
your
the center of the meat, cushions on the seat,
Abu
houses on the
blue.
Street where it's sunny.
You'd bet that Joe
summer's at the sea, winter's warm,
had nothing on you.
I don't forget
but
that when
is
you
the lamb for the sun and you'll
stand
for his
guest.
Yes, it's all for the best.
Some when men you feel are sad, born to live at ease, doing what they please,
under
and
a curse.
The bees are in honey.
Your life is bad.
Never growing old, never feeling
your
cold.
Your prospects are worse.
In air.
Your wife
love
is sighing and crying. And your olive trees dying.
They can't take it with them.
And creditors weighing
your
purse.
They get the
center
of the meat. Cushions on the sea. Houses on the sea where it's sunny.
You'd let that jump.
Summers in the sea, which is warm.
And nothing on you.
Get the rest.
But when you get to sun and the sand,
you guess.
Yes, it's all for the...
You must never be distressed.
Yes, it's all for the...
All your wrongs will be redressed.
Yes, it's all for the...
Someone's got to be oppressed.
Yes, it's all for the best.
Kerry O'Malley and Kerry O'Malley. And watch Snowpiercer, folks. It's really good. Our next song is from a musical called West Side Story, which had a book by Arthur Lawrence, music by Leonard Bernstein, and lyrics by a new up-and-coming lyricist named Stephen Sondheim. The show opened at the Winter Garden Theater on September 26th, 1957, got great reviews and ran for 732 performances. Now, the original plan for West Side Story back in 1947, a year I know very well, since I was born in that year, don't do the math, please. The original plan was for it to be a musical version of Romeo and Juliet, with the conflict between Irish Catholics and Jews, and it was going to be called East Side Story. Well, that version went nowhere fast, and some years later, it transmogrified into the show we know now, which is, of course, a masterpiece. There was a hit movie version in 1961 that won 10 Academy Awards. A hit London production, countless revivals, including one that was about to open when Broadway shut down, directed by Ivo Van Hove, or is it Ivo Van? You say Ivo, and I say Ivo. You say TiVo, and I don't know what I'm doing anymore, which is what happens when I don't read from the paper, ladies and gentlemen. Anyway, and you know, Steven Spielberg just made a new film version. We'll see what that's like, won't we? Here to sing one of the show's great songs and a song that made this singer want to be in musicals, please welcome Daniel Bellusci.
Could be, who knows? There's something due any day, I will know right away, soon as it shows. It may come cannonballing down through the sky, gleaming its eye bright as a rose. Who knows? It's only just out of reach, down the block on a beach, under a tree. I got a feeling there's a miracle due, gonna come true, coming to me. Something's coming, something good, if I can wait. Something's coming, I don't know what it is, but it is gonna be great. With a click, with a shock, phone will jingle, door will knock, open the latch. Something's coming, don't know when, but it's soon. Catch the moon, one-handed catch. Around something, come on in, don't be shy, meet a guy, pull up a chair. Maybe tonight.
Bellusci. Before we go 1 minute more, can I just introduce you to our fabulous musical director, Richard Allen.
Hey, Bruce. Hey, everybody.
Next up, we get in our Kritzerland time machine and go back to a little year I like to call 1960. Now, in December of that year, I had just turned 13 years of age. I'd had my bar mitzvah and was therefore, according to the Today I Am a Man speech, I became Bruce Kimmel Man. And being a man, I had my first date a couple of weeks later, just before the end of that year. The girl was named Betty Bremer. This is true. She was as cute as a button, even with her buck teeth. And we went to the Four Star Theater to see a new movie called Where the Boys Are. We sat in the back row, and while the movie was unspooling, I, Bruce Kimmel, man, had my first kiss. It was pretty innocent, and her teeth did cut my lip, but it was my first kiss, and therefore I have always loved the title song of Where the Boys Are, which brings that whole thing back to me. It was originally sung in the film, and she's in the film as well, by Connie Francis. It was written by the great Neil Sedaka and lyricist Howard Greenfield. The song reached number 4 on the Billboard chart. In 1984, there was a remake or reboot, as the YouTube influencers would say. That was horrible. It was produced by Alan Carr. But that title song was something else, so we had to do it for you tonight. Here to sing Where the Boys Are, please welcome Sami Staitman. But today we know where the boys are, don't we? They're at home or out wearing masks and social distancing, except in Florida, which is coincidentally where the movie took place. Some things never change. Our next song isn't from anything, but it was certainly a huge influence on me when I was a newly turned teen, because I'd never heard anything quite like it. Back then, it was completely unique. I discovered it in 1963 and became completely obsessed with it. The song was and is called Bluesette. It was written in 1961 by the great jazz harmonica and guitar player Toots Thielemans. Has a lyric by Norman Gimbel, who wrote the English lyrics to the songs from The Umbrellas of Cherbourg, as well as many hits like Killing Me Softly with his song. The song was a hit, and it's been sung by hundreds of singers ever since, including my close personal friend, Guy Haines. Thankfully, he won't be singing it tonight because we have a real singer. So to sing Bluesette, won't you please welcome Adrienne Stiefel.
Lucky day you're waking, and your blues will be forsaken. One lucky day, lovely love will come your way. Long as there's love in your heart to share, dear Bluesette, don't despair. Some blue boy is longing just like you to find a someone to be true to. Two loving arms he can nestle in and stay. Get set, Bluesette, true love is coming. Your troubled heart soon will be humming. La 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 la.
Stiefel. Now, back in 1958, I saw a movie I absolutely fell in love with called The Five Pennies, starring Danny Kaye, Barbara Bel Geddes, and as Danny's daughter, the cutest girl I had ever seen in my life, Susan Gordon. Now, as you'll hear later, Danny Kaye was already a huge influence on me, so of course I went on opening day to see The Five Pennies. I developed a huge crush on Susan Gordon, and I fell in love with two songs from the film, the title song and a song called Lullaby and Ragtime, both written by Danny Kaye's brilliant wife, Sylvia Fine. Now, as it turns out, our next singer was also hugely influenced by Danny Kaye, so this put together was a natural for him. Here to sing The Five Pennies and Lullaby and Ragtime, here's Robert Yacko.
This little penny is to wish on and make your wishes come true. This little penny is to dream on and dream of all you can do. This little penny is a dancing penny. See how it glitters and it glows, as bright as a whistle light, as a thistle, quick, quick as a wink, up on his twinkling toes. Oh, this little penny is to laugh on. To see the tears never fall. And this little penny is the last little penny, and most important of all. For this penny is to love on, and where love is, heaven is there. So with just 5 pennies, if they're these 5 pennies, you'll be a millionaire. Won't you play the music so the cradle can rock to a lullaby in ragtime? Sleepy hands are creeping to the end of the clock. Play a lullaby in ragtime. You can tell the Sandman is on his way by the way that they play. As still as the trill of a thrush in a twilight hush, so you can hear the rhythm of the ripples on the side of the boat as you sail away to dreamland. High above the moon you hear a silvery note as the Sandman takes your hand. So rock-a-bye, my baby, don't you cry, my baby, sleepy time is nigh. Won't you rock me to a ragtime lullaby? So with just 5 pennies, if they're these 5 pennies, you'll be a millionaire.
Now, just because you're dying to know, when I began writing my blog back in November of 2001, by the way, it's the longest running daily blog in the history of the internet. I have never missed a day since late November of 2001. I asked early, like the first week, whatever happened to Susan Gordon? And a high school friend on that very day just happened to Google me, found my blog, and the next thing I know, Susan is IMing me. Remember IM? Anybody remember IM on AOL? And we finally met and became really, really close friends. She was a wonderful, wonderful girl. Now we move on to Bells Are Ringing, a show written specifically for Judy Holliday by Comden and Green and Julie Stein. The show opened at the Schubert Theater on November 29th, 1956, where it ran for 924 performances. It was directed by Jerome Robbins and had choreography by Robbins and some up-and-coming choreographer named Bob Fosse. The score produced several standards, including The Party's Over and Just in Time. I produced the Revival cast album back in 2001, starring Faith Prince. Now, I first saw Bells Are Ringing in the summer of 1960 when the movie came out, and I fell head over heels in love with it. And this next song is, for me, one of the greatest introductory character songs in musical theater history. An opening number, an I Want song, and a charm song all rolled into one. In the show, it's sung by Ella Peterson, a gal who works in an answering service who meddles in the lives of the clients and who's secretly in love with one of them. Now, how many of you are old enough to remember telephone prefixes? Well, once upon a time, all telephone numbers had prefixes. They weren't all numbers like today, and we didn't have area codes on top of that. When I was a kid, our prefix was TE, which stood for Texas. So our phone number was Texas 02518. Call it now and see if I'm there. So anyway, let's go back to that era with a song that's all about a phone number that begins with the prefix Plaza. To sing It's a Perfect Relationship, please welcome Hartley Powers.
I'm in love with a man, Plaza 044433. perfect relationship. I can't see him, he can't see me. I'm in love with a voice. Plaza O, double four, double three. What a perfect relationship. I talk to him, and he just talks to me. And yet I can't help wondering what does he look like? Is he 6'7" or 3'2"? Has he eyes of brown or baby blue? Big and miney or underfed? Trimmed black mustache or beard of red? Can he dance like Fred Astaire? Is he dark or is he fair? Pompadour or not a hair? Well, I don't care. That's how things should always be. Our love can never lose its mystery. Cause I'll never meet him, and he'll never meet me. No, he'll never meet me. With a big cigar, as handsome as a movie star, stern as an eagle, shy as a dove, a face that only a mother could love. It doesn't matter what he is, I'm his, his, his. But he's still just a voice. Plaza O, double four, double three. What a perfect relationship. I talk to him, he talks to me. He calls me mommy, thinks I'm 63. And I'll never meet him, and he'll never meet me. No, he'll never meet me.
Hartley Powers. Back in 1997, I was contacted by a wonderful woman named Helene Blue, who was the administrator of Charles Strauss's publishing. Apparently, her friend, Ira Levin, the author, had heard my recording of She's Roses from Drat the Cat, the musical he'd written with composer Milt Schaefer. The show had opened at the Martin Beck Theater on October 10th, 1965, where it only ran 8 performances. Anyway, Ira wanted to meet with me about maybe recording the entire score on a studio cast album, so I set up a meeting on my next trip to New York. I walked in, and there was Mr. Levin, one of my all-time writer heroes, with Rosemary's Baby being one of my favorite novels ever. So I handed him my first edition of Rosemary's Baby, and I told him that I wouldn't even think about recording Drat the Cat until he'd written me a lovely inscription in the book and signed it. This he did immediately, and before he could say anything else, as soon as he handed me back the book, I told him I would record the show, and so I did, and it was one of my favorite recording experiences ever. It's always amazing when a flop show produces a hit song, but Drat the Cat did when Barbara Streisand recorded He Touched Me. But in the show, it's the male lead song, so to do the great She Touched Me, here's the star of our studio cast recording, someone Ira Levin adored. Won't you welcome Jason Graae?
Please say hello to my dear friend and musical director, Mr. Alex Rybak. Oh, I've got to turn him on. Is she really real? Was she really there? Or did I somehow just imagine her as starving men see menus in the air? No. No, I didn't imagine her. She's real. She smiled at me. She spoke to me. She gave me a flower. She touched me. She put her hand on mine. Right there, she touched me. I feel a sort of tingle where she touched me. A sparkle, a glow. She knew it. It wasn't accidental, no, she knew it. She smiled and seemed to tell me so. She knew it, I know. She's real, and the world is alive and shining. I feel such a wonderful drive toward Valentine. I simply have to face the fact she touched me. Control myself and try to act as if I remember my name. But she touched me. She touched me. And suddenly, nothing is the same. One touch and New York is a part of heaven. One touch and I'm handsome and smart and 6 feet seven. She touched me. I simply have to face the fact she touched me. Control myself and try to act as if I remember my name. But she touched me. She touched me. And suddenly, nothing is the same.
Jason Graae. I don't think it's much of a secret that I'm an L.A. native, or how the magical city that L.A. used to be impacted my life. Of my 20 books, both fiction and non, in every one of them, Los Angeles plays a major, major role. They are really true L.A. books. And so several years ago, I had the idea to create a musical review about L.A., which I called L.A. Now and Then. We had a really successful run at Los Angeles City College with a mix of pros and students. I wrote a lot of it, but I also enlisted other writers to contribute, folks like Bruce Valanche, Shelley Markham, Adrienne Russ, Michelle Browerman, Paul Gordon, Grant Geisman, David Wechter, and of course, the great Richard Sherman. As I mentioned before, I love writing opening numbers, and I had great fun writing the one that opened L.A. Now and Then. So here to sing This Is the City, here's Kerry O'Malley.
This is the city, Los Angeles, wacky and weird and wild. Sometimes it's pretty, sometimes it's a spoiled and entitled child. And LA's unique, and sometimes it's chic, and sometimes a freak show too. This is the city, so check out the view. this is the city. Los Angeles spread out diverse and wide. Sometimes it's gritty, sometimes it's a crazy and scary ride. A city that thinks, a city that winks, a city with pinks, that's us. This is the city, no muss and no fuss. No muss, no fuss, except that they tear down buildings, they build new buildings, tear down more buildings, sad but true. We have the red cars, they killed the red cars, we've got the red line, deja vu. What else is new? LA's a contradiction, ignores its history, forgets its past. LA's a glorious beast with at least a few things that somehow last. LA, now and then, a city where everything old is suddenly new again. This is the city, Los Angeles, it's got a lot to share. Sometimes it's witty, sometimes it's a pain in the you-know-where. Yes, LA is nuts, no ifs, ands, or buts, you never know what's in store. This is the city that you can't ignore. LA, sometimes you are dazzling, sometimes you just sparkle, sometimes you just gleam. LA, sometimes you're confusing, sometimes an enigma, sometimes just a dream. LA, there's nothing like you. Sometimes you're easy, sometimes you're tough, and sometimes you're cheesy. But as crazy as things can get, we simply can't get enough. This is the city, Los Angeles, somehow the damn thing thrives. Come on, take pity, we sit on the freeway for half our lives. A city that's strange, a city of change, a city where angels play. This is the city, we call our own, this is the city, it's all our own, this is the city. Welcome to L.A.
Back in 1962, I had just started high school. I was at that time already a big cast album collector, and that year I bought a new cast album of a show that would be a life changer for me. Stop the World, I Want to Get Off. I was so intrigued that one person had starred in the show, directed the show, and co-written the book, music, and lyrics, that person being Anthony Newley and his co-writer being Leslie Brickus. After hearing that album, playing it to death, I knew I wanted to do all that. I wanted to do all those things, and thankfully, eventually I did. The show began in the UK. David Merrick saw it and brought it to Broadway, where it opened at the Schubert Theater on October 3rd, 1962, running 555 performances. The national tour came to LA in 1963, starring Joel Grey and Julie Newmar, if you can picture that. 5'4" and 6'1". I saw it four times during its 2 or 3 week run here at the Huntington Hartford Theater. I still have my program, ladies and gentlemen. Joel Grey, Julie Newmar, in case you were wondering. So anyway, 3 years later, I actually got to play Little Chap in the show, and 3 years after that, I got to play him again, this time in summer stock in Lake Swannanoa, New Jersey, as the people were landing on the moon. That's when that was. Here to do my favorite song in the show, Once in a Lifetime, welcome back, Daniel Bellusci.
Just once in a lifetime, a man knows a moment. One wonderful moment when fate takes his hand. And this is my moment, my once in a lifetime, when I can explore a new and exciting land. feel like a giant. I soar like an eagle, as though I had wings. For this is my moment. My destiny calls me, and though it may be just once in my lifetime, I'm gonna do great things. For once in my lifetime, I feel like a giant. I soar like an eagle, as though I had wings. For this is my moment. My destiny calls me. And though it may be just once in my lifetime, I'm gonna do great things.
I think it's safe to say that anyone who came of age in musical theater from the 1960s on was influenced somehow by my close personal friend, Mr. Stephen Sondheim, especially starting in 1970 with his groundbreaking musical Company. And 17 years later, Into the Woods opened at the Martin Beck Theater on November 5th, 1987, where it ran for 765 performances. The book was by James Lapine, who also directed the show. It's been revived any number of times over the years, both here and overseas, and it, of course, got the big screen treatment thanks to director Rob Marshall and Disney. Here to sing one of Sondheim's most heartfelt songs, and a song that truly resonates more and more with each passing day, please welcome the amazing Emily Skinner.
How do you save your child in the night? Nothing's all black, but the nothing's all white. How do you say it will all be all right, when you know that it mightn't be true? What do you do? Careful the things you say. Children will listen. Careful the things you do. Children will see and learn. Children may not obey, but children will listen. Children will look to you for which way to turn. To learn what to be. Careful before you say, listen to me. Children will listen. Careful the wish you make. Wishes are children. Careful the path they take, wishes come true. Not free. Careful the spell you cast, not just on children. Sometimes the spell may last past what you can see and turn against you. Careful the tale you tell, that is the spell. Children will listen. Guide them and stuff away. Children will glisten. Tamper with what is true, and children will turn, if just to be free. Careful the tale you tell, that is the spell. Children will listen, children will listen.
Emily Skinner. Now, I mentioned before that Danny Kaye was a huge influence on me, and that influence began with an album of 78s. Anybody remember 78s? 78 RPM records? Sadly, I do. And what's even more frightening is that I'm only 6 years away from being 78. I loved the way he sang, and especially the tongue twisters Danny Kaye did. And then we had the life changer moment in 1956 when I saw The Court Jester in Technicolor and VistaVision. I saw it over and over again because I made family members take me to whatever theater was playing it. I wanted to be Danny Kaye. I wanted to wear that black fox outfit. I wanted to swing on vines and be dashing and have daring do, just like Danny did. I walked around all day saying, get it? Got it. Good. And the pellet with the poisons and the vessel with the pestle, but the chalice from the palace has the brew that is true. Can you all say that with me now, please? The vessel with the pestle has the pellet with the poison. The chalice from the palace has the brew that is true. Of course, they broke the vessel with the pestle, so the flagon with the dragon has the pellet with the poison. No, is it the chalice from the pleasel with the fleesman, the flamen with the... Okay, fine. Mostly I wanted to sing those incredible songs written by Danny's wife. I have lost my mind, ladies and gentlemen. By Danny's wife, Sylvia Kaye. She wrote most of them with writer Sami Khan. Some of them she wrote on her own, including the one I loved the most, her masterpiece, The Maladjusted Jester. I performed it on the Bruce Kimmel Hour, my little Jew version of the Ed Sullivan Show that I did for our bi-monthly family dinners with me as all of the acts. And all these years later, I still remember it. Once learned, never forgotten. Now, Guy Haines was actually going to be here tonight to do it for you, but he's on Zoom doing a reading of a one-man musical show based on the life of Russell Knight. It's for all of our obscure musical theater fans, Russell Knipe. Very exciting it is, very exciting. I've seen a few snippets from the Russell Knipe musical on Zoom. Zoom is very exciting in itself, ladies and gentlemen. Anyway, I hope you don't mind if I fill in for him tonight. Maestro, can you give me a maladjusted vamp, please? When I was a lad, I was gloomy and sad, as I was from the day I was born. While other babes giggled and gurgled and wiggled, I proudly was loudly forlorn. My friends and my family looked at me clammily, thought there was something amiss. While others found various antics hilarious, all I could manage was this, or this, or this. My father, he shouted, he needs to be clouded, his teeth on a wreath, I'll hand him. My mother, she cried as she rushed to my side, you're a brute and you don't understand him. So they sent for a witch with a terrible twitch, and asked how my future impressed her. She took one look at me and cried, hee. What else could he be but a jester? A jester? A jester? A funny idea, a jester. No butcher, no baker, no candlestick maker, and me with the look of a fine undertaker impressed her. As a jester? Now where could I learn any comical turn that was not on a book on a shelf? No teacher to take me to mold me or make me a merry man, fool, or an elf. But I'm proud to recall that in no time at all, with no other recourses but my own resources, with firm application and determination, I made a fool of myself. I bought a bow and arrow and I learned to shoot. I bought a little horn and I learned to toot. Now I can shoot and toot, ain't that cute? I started to travel to try to unravel my mind and to find a new chance. When I got to Spain, it was suddenly plain that the field that appealed was the dance. The Spanish were clannish, but I wouldn't vanish. I learned every step they had planned. But the first step of all isn't hard to recall, because the first step of all is to stand. And stand. And stand. They sometimes stand like this for days. Ricardo, play that music. I was battered and bruised, but the king was amused, and before a siesta he made me his jester, and I found it soon that to be a buffoon is a serious thing as a rule, for a jester's chief employment is to kill himself for your enjoyment, and a jester unemployed is nobody's fool. Thank you so much. Oh, dear Lord. See what you can remember if you put your mind to it. Not that I have a mind anymore. Next up, we have a put together of two songs I absolutely loved as a young teen. The first, Love Look Away, is from the Rodgers and Hammerstein musical Flower Drum Song, which opened at the St. James Theater on December 1st, 1958, where it would run for 600 performances, the longest running show of that season. It had a tour, a film version, but it wasn't produced much after that, and certainly no one would touch it in the last two decades, because producers feared audiences would not understand the context of when the show was written. So instead, the show had a revisal in 2002, and when I say a revisal, it had a completely new book by and plot by David Henry Hwang, which retained most of the songs, but seemingly made it more palatable for today's audiences. Except that today's audiences didn't like it, and it only ran 169 performances. Oh, well. We've paired it with Here's That Rainy Day by Johnny Burke and James Van Heusen, which became an instant standard back in 1953. What several people don't know, however, is that it was from a show, a big flop Broadway musical entitled Carnival in Flanders, which opened at the New Century Theater on September 8th, 1953, where it played all of six performances. Here to sing these two classics, here's Adrienne Stiefel.
Here
Next up, we have a little put together of two great Julie Stein, Comden and Green songs from one great big flop musical, Subways Are for Sleeping. I got the cast album of that from the Columbia Record Club. It had a beautiful gatefold jacket that opened up and had pictures and a synopsis. I fell totally in love with the score. And when I finally read up on the show and found out what a flop it was, I couldn't really fathom how that great a score could be from that great a flop. And that actually started my lifelong obsession with flops. Subways Are for Sleeping opened on December 27, 1961 at the St. James Theater, starred Carol Lawrence and Sidney Chaplin, and in the chorus a very young 18-year-old newcomer by the name of Michael Bennett. It actually managed to run for 205 performances thanks to David Merrick's infamous publicity ploy. And because the show had received almost unanimous pans from the major critics, Mr. Merrick found people who had the same names as the critics who'd panned the show, invited those people to see the show, and then got quotes for them, which he used in the ads. They don't make them like David Merrick anymore, folks. Here to sing Comes Once in a Lifetime and How Can You Describe a Face? Here's Robert Yacko.
Every day, just go along dawn till sundown. Here's the rundown. Every day that comes, comes once in a lifetime. Take each day and gather the rosebuds in it, fill each minute. Every day that comes, comes once in a lifetime. Think of now, tomorrow is waiting in the wings. Who knows what it brings? While the future waits, the present swings from day to day. In Brooklyn or China, across the bay, only once comes this particular sky. Only once these precious hours will fly. Only once in a lifetime today comes by. So live, live, live today. Eyes of brown, or were they blue? Her hair all cloud, the sun shone through. Her mouth was sad, yet somehow gay. It's very hard to say how she looked, how she spoke, how she smiled. Oh, her smile had such a special glow, I can't begin to tell you, though I'm trying. How can you describe a face? A curving line defined her cheek, the way she held her head unique. Voice as sweet as singing birds. I'll never find the words for that look when she gazed in my eyes. Such a funny look, so warm and real. It made me glad, yet made me feel like crying. How can you describe a face? What's the sense of using words like beautiful? A different eye sees different things as beautiful. How to put in words her rare expression? As open as the sky, elusive as a sign. Eyes of brown, or were they blue? Her hair a cloud, the sun shone through. I guess there's no use trying. I just can't describe her face. How can you describe a face?
So, the way I discovered one of my favorite songwriting teams, Harvey Schmidt and Tom Jones, was the same way I think most people discovered them, via the cast album of The Fantastics, which I found one day while thumbing through the cast album LPs at Wallace Music City, Sunset and Vine. I'd gone that morning to the Huntington Hartford Theater just up the street to get a single ticket to see what would be my very first play, Patty Chayefsky's The Tenth Man. I had a couple of hours to kill, so I walked the half block down to Wallach's, where I found this weird-looking album that was all white background and only had purple lettering on it that said, in this weird lettering, The Fantastics. Later, I learned that was actually Harvey Schmidt's handwriting. That's how he wrote. So if you got letters from Harvey, which I did, that's what they would look like. Anyway, they had listening booths at Wallach's. So I took the LP into one of them and sat there for the next 40 minutes, not believing the music and lyrics I was hearing. So unique, so clever, so beautiful. And that score was a huge, huge influence on me. The Fantastics opened on May 3rd, 1960 at the small Sullivan Street Playhouse, where it would run for an astonishing 17,162 performances. The longest-running musical in history and the longest-running uninterrupted show of any kind in the United States. I met Harvey Schmidt in 1990, and he became one of my dearest friends right up until he passed away a year ago. He was also a wonderful artist, and he did the covers for my first three novels. So, you know, we had to do a put-together of fantastic songs. Here to sing I Can See That and They Were You, here's Daniel Bellusci.
I can see it shining somewhere. Bright light somewhere, invite me to come there and learn. And I'm ready, I can hear it siren singing. Inside my ear, I hear them all singing. Come learn. Who knows? Maybe all the visions that I see may be waiting just for me to say, take me there and make me see it. Make me feel it. I know it's so, I know that it really may be just what I've always waited for. This is what my life's created for. Let me learn. When the young, when the month was May, when the stage was hung for my holiday,
I saw shining lights, but I never knew they were you, they were you, they were you. When the dance was done, when I went my way, when I tried to find rainbows far away, all the lovely lights seemed to fade from view. They were you, they were you, they were you. Without you I can't see when you're near me. Wonderful things come to be. Every secret prayer, every fancy free, everything I dared for both you and me. All my wildest dreams multiplied by two. They were you, they were you, they were you. They were you, they were you, they were you.
Another huge influence on just about anyone who wrote pop songs in the 1960s was, of course, Burt Bacharach, who, with Hal David, wrote many of that decade's biggest hits and most iconic songs. They only wrote one Broadway musical, but it was a game changer in terms of its score, its orchestrations, and most importantly, its sound. Promises, Promises, based on Billy Wilder's film The Apartment, with a book by Neil Simon and a score by Bacharach and David, opened at the Schubert Theater on December 1st, 1968, where it would run 1,281 performances. I moved to New York 3 weeks after Promises opened and saw it on my second day there. It was the first show to ever use a mixing board. There was a terrible revival a few years ago that was terrible. I won't mention any names, but it was directed by Rob Ashford. Anyway, better was when Encores did it with Martin Short in the lead. In that production, the female lead was played by a wonderfully talented young woman, and we've got her with us tonight. So here to sing Whoever You Are, I Love You, here's Kerry O'Malley.
Yet I'm sure
it's just not so. I get this feeling on my own after I learn if you're staying or if you're going.
Know that in 107 shows, we have never done a single Jacques Brel song. Well, we're about to fix that, almost, because our next song was a very influential one in the life of the gentleman who's about to sing it. Amusingly, Brel didn't actually write this particular song. He only sang it, but had a big hit with it. It's considered a Brel song because his hit was so big. But the actual writers were Jean Corti and Gerard Jouannet. The song was put into the hit revue Jacques Brel Is Alive and Well and Living in Paris, which opened off Broadway in 1968. What am I, Inspector Clouseau all of a sudden? The myth. There's a myth in the room. No. It opened off-Broadway in 1968 and played for 4 years there. The English lyrics were by Eric Grau and Mort Schumann. Here to sing and play Madeleine, here's Jason Graae.
Hello. I'd now like to sing a song for you, Line. Oh. I'd now like to sing a song for you that has been part of my life and repertoire for, over 40 years. I first sang it, of course, a lot of you will remember, when I won the Tulsa chapter of the Elks Talent Show with it. And it was a really, really competitive year that year. I beat out a hula dancer from Nathan Hale High School. So I felt pretty good about that. And now I hope you'll enjoy Madeleine by Jacques Brel. I'm waiting for Madeleine in front of the picture show every night at 10:30. Madeleine, she'll love that so. I'm waiting for Madeleine. We'll go down and eat at Joe's. French fries are from who knows when, but Madeleine, she'll love that so. Madeleine's my Christmas tree. She's America to me. I know that she's too good for me. That's what her mother always says. I'm waiting for Madeleine. We'll go to the picture show. I'll tell her that I love her then. Madeleine, she'll love that so. She's much more than pretty. She is all that you know. She is my whole life to me. I love my Madeleine so, so. I'm waiting for Madeleine, but I'm getting soaking wet. I've been soaked since 10:30. Madeleine is not here yet. I'm waiting for Madeleine. Joe's is close by now, I'll bet. No French fries from who knows when, but Madeleine is not here yet. Madeleine's my shining sea. She's America to me. I know that she's too good for me. That's what her father always says. I'm waiting for Madeleine. We'll go to the picture show. I'll tell her that I'd love her then. Madeleine, she'll love that so. She is much more than pretty. She is all that you know. She is my whole life to me. I love my Madeleine so. I waited for Madeleine.
I only have myself to blame. I went and caught a cold again, and Middle Age never came. I wish for my late. All I did was call his name. Madeline's my shining sea. She's America to me. It's true that she's too good for me. That's what her brother. I waited for Madeline. It's always been the same. Waiting here since who knows when. Madeline, she never came. She is much more than pretty. She is all that you know. She is my life to me. I love my Madeline so. Everybody! I'm gonna wait for Madeline in front of the picture show tomorrow night at 10:30. Madeline, you love that so? I'm gonna wait for Madeline. We'll go down and eat at Joe's. French fries are from who knows when, but Madeline, you love that so? Madeline's my Christmas tree. She's America to me. So what if she's too good for me? And her mother, I hated her mother. I hated her so much that the flames. Oh, I'm gonna wait for Madeline. We'll go to the picture show. I'll tell her that I love her then. Madeline, she'll love that song. Oh, oh.
Now we have another put together, two songs by my close personal friend, Stephen Sondheim. The first, With So Little to Be Sure Of, is from Anyone Can Whistle, which opened at the Majestic Theater on April 4th, 1964, where it ran for just 9 performances. But that cast album was the first score by Sondheim that made me think this guy was kind of a genius. The second song is Who Could Be Blue, which was cut from the musical Follies. I did this arrangement for the Stephen Sondheim album, which I produced, and I cannot tell you how thrilled we are to have the gentleman who sang it on that album, so won't you please welcome the wonderful Norm Lewis.
With so little to be sure of, if there's anything at all, if there's anything at all I'm sure of, here and now and us together, all I'll ever be I owe you. If there's anything makes me sure enough of me. Thanks for everything we did, everything that's past, everything that's over too fast. None of it was wasted, all of it will last. Everything that's here and now and us, it was marvelous to know you, and it really isn't through. Crazy business, this life we live in. Can't complain about the time we're given. With so little to be sure of in this world. Who could be blue, knowing there's you somewhere nearby? So how shares you with me. The only thing blue is the sky. It was marvelous to know you, and it really isn't through. Crazy business, this life we live in. Can't complain about the time we're given. With so little to be sure of in this world.
Norm Lewis. Now, before we do our final number, may I just thank a few folks, but how many of you out there in the Facebook and YouTube live land have been watching our show in three dimensions? It's fabulous. I've been watching all the numbers. Oh, my God. Ooh, where's, oh, there. Ooh, look at that. Look at that. A 3D effect. Marvelous. I just love the three dimensions. Before we do our final number, may I just thank a few folks. I realize I said that already, but you know. First and foremost, Hartley Powers for making all of this happen so smoothly. She's the technical brains behind our online shows. Hartley Powers, ladies and gentlemen.
Hi.
I'd also like to thank our co-producer, the artistic director of the Group Rep Theater, whenever theater is allowed to come back, Doug Haverty. In fact, tonight's show is a benefit for all the wonderful small theaters in North Hollywood. Our last two shows were benefits specifically for the Group Rep. The Group Rep does benefit from the one that we're doing tonight, but it's for all the small theaters in North Hollywood, all of whom are suffering and trying to survive until they can open again. If you have the wherewithal and can, please make a donation. The link is on both the Facebook and YouTube live pages, and all donations are tax deductible. And there's a little thing on our screen that told you where to donate. Also, many thanks to our musical director, who I do believe has lost his sanity during the stay-at-home, Richard Allen.
Great job, everybody. See you next month. Stay safe. Stay safe.
To close the show, here's a put-together of two songs from a little musical I like to call Annie, a show that was very important to the singer who's about to do these songs, as she played the title role for 5 years straight in various LA productions of the show and also did a tour of the show. Here's Adrienne Stiefel.
Your bottom dollar that tomorrow
just thinking about tomorrow clears away the cobwebs and the sorrow till there's none. But I'm stuck with a day that's gray and lonely. I just stick up my chin and grin.
Michael Gabiano, Ali Gutierrez, Chloe Haven, John Massey, Ellie Oliver, Scott Sr., Mackenzie Wrap, Sami Staitman, Hartley Powers, Daniel Bellusci, Robert Yacko, Kerry O'Malley, Jason Graae, Norm Lewis, Emily Skinner. We'll be back in August with a brand new show. We're already working on it, and it's going to be so much fun. We're hoping maybe by September we'll have a shot at being back at Feinstein's upstairs in Fatello. But if we're not, you can bet your bottom dollar that we'll be having our 10th anniversary show right here on Facebook and YouTube Live. Stay safe, stay happy, stay positive, be well, and we'll see you next month. Thank you.